seminarians sometimes have to go through in their training for priests is something called clinical pastoral education. I did mine where I worked as a chaplain in Sacred Heart Hospital down in Spokane. And one of the resources that was suggested to us was this book called Handbook for Mortals, Guidance for People Facing Serious Illness. And what's very nice about this book is it goes through how to live with a serious illness, dealing with the changes, the sense of loss that you sometimes go through, finding meaning in life when you're faced with a serious illness, planning for eventual death, and then it outlines what to expect with certain terminal illnesses like cancer or AIDS or things like that, and also dealing with children with death and dying and things like that. And it's non-denominational. There were physicians, there were rabbis, there were priests, there were ministers that were all involved in putting this book together. And it's a very, very good resource for dealing with some of these issues more in depth, things that we won't get into here because we're kind of trying to stick as general as possible.
We're going to get a copy.
You should be able to just order it online.
No.
Barnes & Noble should be able to help you, or I can help you order it.
Is there an author on
this? Yes, the authors are Joanne Lynn, Joan Harold with two R's. They're the main authors of this book.
Can you give the full title?
Handbook for Mortals, Guidance for People Facing Serious Illness. Well, now that we've talked about what to expect at the end of life, we're going to transition into making preparations for death. And the second talk is going to deal primarily with funeral homes and funeral arrangements. And so I'd like to introduce to all of you Keith Blanchard. He's the general manager of Chapel of Chimes Funeral Homes here in Fairbanks. He is also Catholic himself, and so he's very aware of the church's practices and beliefs, which we'll talk about after lunch. But he's here to share with you just some general guidelines and things to think about as you prepare for your own funeral. And so at this time, I'll turn it over to Keith.
Thank you, Father. Again, my name is Keith Blanchard. I'm with Chapel of Chimes Funeral Home and with Northern Lights Mortuary Memorial Park up on Miller Hill on Yankovich. I've been a funeral director now going on 17 years. And grew up in my family's funeral home business back in Ohio. We started back in 1870, five generations ago. So my family came down from Canada and became their woodworkers. And back in the day, all the woodworkers in town made all the cabinets and therefore made coffins and started the business of undertaking back then. Moved into the big city Toledo in 1890, and that's where my family still resides back home. Been here in Alaska now, this will be 6 years this February. My first 2 years here in Alaska, I was at Fairbanks Funeral Home. And for the last 3.5, almost 4 years now, I've been over at Chapel of Chimes. My wife is also a funeral director, non-practicing now. She works over at the Monroe Foundation with High Pal. Her name's Amanda Blanchard. We picked the Fairbanks area because it had the K-12 Catholic school. We didn't have one person in the whole state when we moved up. So we just sold everything, pickup truck. Let's go to Alaska. So I'd never been west of Chicago until I came here. So long story short, we have two children. My son's in eighth grade over at Monroe Junior High, and my daughter is in sixth grade at ICS. And so we stay pretty active over there. We live next door to Chapel Chimes in the White House in the corner. I don't know if anybody is familiar with that house, but that's where Fred Noyes started over on the Garden Island with his lumber company, and the house has gone through a lot of transitions over the years. So we live right next door to work, and they're right down the back alley from the school. So we have our own nice little niche. I met Father close to 5.5 years ago, I think fresh out of seminary school at the cathedral, and tried to maintain a good relationship with all the churches here in town, Catholic and, of course, all the other Protestant churches too. So, a little background, I have a bachelor's degree in mortuary science from the University of Cincinnati of Mortuary Science. Cincinnati College of Mortuary Science. They've gone through a couple transitions. I guess what I'd like to do here today is be able to give you information that maybe there's misleading ideas. People tend to think that something is true just because they heard it from somebody else. My job here is to try to dispel a lot of the myths of what you can and cannot do as a family grieving when someone in your family passes. Try to give you as much information as possible to make the best decisions for you. My job when I sit down with families is to give you all of your options, not to point you in any direction. I'm not commission-based pay. I don't make any money depending if you build your own casket or if I sell you a casket. My job is to provide all the options and you make the best decisions for you and your family. What I'd like to do, start off is any questions that you may have before we kind of go through a little bit of the information I have to offer, anything off the top that you have questions for, please just interrupt me at any point in time. You don't have to raise your hand. You can just go ahead and speak, and I'll try to answer all those questions. Any questions starting off? Okay. Well, I don't know if Father Robert had talked at all about the changes in the Catholic Church over the years regarding final disposition, burial, cremation, donation, anything along those lines. But the Catholic Church over the years has allowed cremation more and more often as a means of final disposition, not only because of what they used to say was it was a matter of economics was the reason why they allowed cremation. Now it's more of a standard that they do allow it on pretty much any case. The big thing with the Catholic Church, though, what they want to recognize is that if you do have a cremation, that the ashes stay together. I know a lot of people up here in Alaska, they come through the door and they say, this is what we want to do, we want direct cremation, and then following the cremation process, we're going to go ahead and scatter. As a Catholic, I try to let them know that the Church frowns upon scattering. They also frown upon separating out the ashes into separate urns, where one being scattered here, one being scattered there, the other one sitting up on a mantle. Catholic tradition is that when somebody's laid to rest, they're laid to rest. So they would like to, I guess, have me help remind that if you do choose cremation, that the ashes do stay together and that they're eventually buried in one spot. If someone has done those other things, I'm not one to tell a family you can't do anything. Again, I'm just supposed to objectively give them information to hopefully make the best decision. That decision ultimately is up to the family. Yes?
Did you say that you have to get permission for cremation from the church?
No.
Okay. That you said it's
right. General. Father Robert can probably tell you a little bit more about that. In the almost six years I've been up here, we've never had that type of situation ever arise.
Okay.
And a lot of people personally ask the priest whether or not they think it's allowable, and I've never heard a priest up here say, I don't think that's a good idea. Especially with some of the younger priests that are out now, they have a lot more classes and training on the subject of what the church's teachings are now compared to maybe pre-Vatican II or anything like that. At that point in time, that was just a no-no no matter what. Where my family's funeral home was in Ohio, we had five Catholic parishes within 2 miles of our funeral home. And I want to say, starting full-time back in 93 until I came up here, I want to say maybe less than 10 cremations total. It was a very traditional area that they felt they just needed to go earth burial, casket services and earth burial. So again, regionally, it's a lot different. Back home, 85% burial rate with just 15% cremation rate. And here we're the opposite. We're 85% cremation rate, 15% burial rate. So it's just a big swing. And I think a lot of that has to do with traditional generational values. Like my family, it was just an automatic. Someone passed away. You had a full day visitation the day before from 2 to 9. You had the rosary service at 7 o'clock. Then the next morning, all the family and close friends met at the funeral home. Had prayers before, put the little purple signs on each car, and you went in a procession, non-escorted. It was just common that if the first car made it through the light when it was yellow and it turned red, everybody else kept going through and everybody observed that it was a funeral process procession and would stop. most people on the side of the roads, hats off, you know, bowed their heads. You know, it was just, it was a very traditional thing that was passed on generation to generation. Up here, we do not have that. At least we do not have that yet. There is really no such thing as a processional to the cemetery here or to church, unless it's some type of law enforcement, police, firefighter, some type of civil service that that the police and troopers would handle as an escort itself. So lots of different things that they make you jump through in order to get special permits for that. To get back to the question, though, yeah, there's lots of things have changed over the years, and I do not believe that you need to get permission, but leading up to somebody passed away, or even if it was a sudden death, usually priest is one of the first people you talk to before you come into the funeral home anyway, to kind of get an idea of time frame and what you need to do, what you need to plan next. So definitely that would be an appropriate time just to make sure that the priest is okay with it. But in the almost 6 years I've been here, I've never had family say that the priest thought it was not a good idea. I just want to talk a little bit about the packet I have right here. This is an informational packet. It's not meant to solicit anything or do anything other than provide information. One thing, I was at Department of Vital Statistics yesterday, and I was talking to Leanne there, and she mentioned that she talked to a family not too long ago that said that they wish that they had something on a piece of paper that would help them to know who to contact, who to talk to, now that the funeral is over with and they have the certified copies of the death certificate. What do they need to do? I said, well, I have that form. I'll bring it by and just, I'll make generic copies, take her name off the top, just to give people information. And I think that's one of the first ones on the right-hand side. It's called a checklist, things to be done after someone passes away. These are things that you're working on an emotional time frame. You know you need to get a lot of things done, and it's a very emotional time that you're not thinking clearly about who I need to talk to. And I know a lot of people want to take care of things themselves. They don't want to outsource that to other friends, even though those people want to help out. Some people need to go through that process of doing it themselves. So what we've done is we compiled a list of things that need to be done, whether it be contact an attorney about probate or contact Social Security for benefits for surviving spouses or children. Talks about vehicle registration, property, things that you're going to need to take care of here in the near future. May not happen that week, may not happen that month, but something eventually you may need to talk about. And then what we did here at the bottom part is, you know, we have a lot of services that families will come in and they say, we want cremation. I said, is there going to be a celebration? Like, yes, we're going to take care of that ourselves. I said, that's fine. With this piece of paper, I'll help you out with it. You're going to do services on your own. This is maybe a checklist of things that you need to contact people to help you through that process of getting that celebration of life or memorial service or funeral service completed. So what we've done is we've tried to put things together that we got feedback from families that will help other families in their time of need. Any questions about any of the information that you might see on this? Okay. What we've done, maybe it should be right behind there. There's another sheet here that talks about certified copies of the death certificate, on who may need those and for what reasons they may be needed. The good thing about Fairbanks, I've noticed, is most families in Fairbanks North Pole area, when they go into their local bank, they will take a certified copy of the death certificate, copy it, and then return it back to you. Right now, the state charges $25 for the first copy and $20 for each additional copy. So as you can imagine, those are expensive little pieces of paper. So we try to use this sheet to narrow down how many they're going to need. Because a lot of families come and say, how many do you think I need? I said, well, I'm not sure. They said, someone told me I need to get 20. I said, you know what, you need those 24. They're like, I'm not sure. So pull us out of the packet. We'll go through it and find out what you need specific certified copies of the death certificate for. And they'll go through this and find out what they only need four, which is great. They'll just save them a lot of money on how many certified copies they might have needed. So at any point in time, if a family needs more certified copies, there's two easy ways to get that done. You just call the funeral home. And I say call the funeral home, us, Fairbanks Funeral Home, us up at Northern Lights. They have a funeral home here also in North Pole now, over on Perimeter. You call the funeral home and say, I need more certified copies. The funeral director will then go to Department of Vital Statistics and get those for you, secure those for you. And they